In today's webinar, we will discuss the importance of key performance indicators for monitoring outcomes in your IVF laboratory, as well as monitoring and managing of staff performance. Now, the key elements of my presentation will focus first on the definition of quality. Then we will look at the performance indicators specifically for ART. We will then identify how we can monitor our quality, look at the successes that KPIs in ART might offer, but also the limitations that KPIs have when applied in ART, and then we will summarize. So let's first start with the definition of quality. Now, when we go out for dining, we are four people at the table. We all have our own idea of how the quality of the food is. It was nice tasting, it was a good service, it was really well placed on the plate, and so on. Now, there was one professional organization that really focused on quality of dining out. And this Michelin company started in the years 1900 with the Guide Michelin. And they made evaluation of establishments that were serving food, especially for the customers who had bought Michelin tires on their cars. So while traveling through France, they would have a guide, a list of establishments with good food. Now, in 1936, they set up criteria for a star ranking. And as we all now know, there are high quality, as you can see, with 1-star, 2-star establishments, but also exceptional cuisine, the 3-star establishments. Now there are 30,000 establishments that have been identified of having a star, a good quality or excellent or exceptional quality. They have set 5 criteria to determine which establishment is worth a star. And these criteria are quality of ingredients used, mastery of flavor and cooking techniques, personality of the chef in the cuisine, the value for money, and the consistency between the visits. So the quality indicators or the criteria they used, they give a distinctive characteristic or trait to the dining out or the establishment or the dinner. The quality is a judgment of how excellent something or someone is. And we can check it by analyzing the indicators, as I gave you the example from the Michelin star rating. Now, in healthcare, we also have quality indicators, and they are standardized and they must be evidence-based measures. And they can be used with already available hospital inpatient administrative data to measure and to track clinical performance and outcomes. And with these quality indicators, we could track changes over time, we could highlight potential quality improvement in specific areas. Now, what about performance indicators in ART? We must recognize the extraordinary nature of our work, the nature of assisted reproduction technologies. It's a high complexity medical care specialty with highly skilled professionals and multiple professional specialties involved. We have staff in the laboratory, clinical staff, nursing staff, administrative staff, logistical staff, and so on. The patient's well-being is extremely important because 3 lives are at stake. We want to have well-being for the mother, the father, the embryos, and the potential embryo child that is going to be born. Multiple factors also influence the outcomes. It's not only the quality of the lab or the clinic that will define the outcome, but also the patient themselves, their lifestyle, their pathology, and so on. Local laws and guidelines differ, and ethical guidelines as well, so this makes it really extraordinary. There are low and high turnover clinics. We see an increase in consolidation of centers worldwide, and the IVF market size worth is estimated to hit $850 million by 2022. Quality control, quality assurance, and quality management systems are more and more implemented and mandatory. The focus on delivering quality and improving the quality is also increasing. Now let's look at the performance indicators in RRT and the link with the outcomes. I want to start by describing the first historical data that were obtained in the Free University of Brussels while performing the first ICSIS. The group there recorded their data and recorded the percentage of intact oocytes. So they looked at the percentage of oocytes that had not degenerated after the ICSI. They also looked at the normal fertilization rate, so the 2PN rate, and the 1 pronuclear fertilization rate. They then put us in a timely scale, so from the first month of 91 to the fourth month of 95, and looked at the outcomes. And what they could see was that after roughly a year and 2 months, there was a standardization of the technique. The percentage, so the blue bar of intact oocyte, had increased and was stable. It was still roughly between 10 and 7%. The normal fertilization was about 65%. And the 1 pronuclear fertilization rate had dropped from more than 10% to roughly 1%. So they were using these indicators to see how the technique was evolving and when it was stable and when it was standardized. So these were the first performance indicators that were used to demonstrate that the technique was working. Many years later, in 2012 and in 2017, highly experienced embryologists came together and made a consensus. They made a report on the development of ART laboratory performance indicators. And this was the Alpha Group, the International Society for Sciences in Reproductive Medicine, and the ESHRE Special Interest Group of Embryologists. So how did they do this? Well, they sent out surveys to different societies, international and national societies. They sent a survey to members of the ESHRE Committee of National Representatives. They sent it as well to members of the ESHRE Special Interest Group of Embryology. And they asked what the frequency of measurement was of KPIs, if there were, of course, KPIs being used, how many KPIs and what they were, and the characteristics of the reference population, and the degree of importance of these quality performance indicators. They also looked at the published data in literature and at meetings, and also used their personal clinical experience to come up with a suggestion of KPIs in ART. So the Alpha Consensus and the Vienna Consensus came up with 3 categories of indicators. These are the reference indicators, the performance indicators, and the key performance indicators. The reference indicators are related to the oocytes coming into the lab, so they are like a proxy indicator of response to the ovarian stimulation. The performance indicators are those of which data are being recorded and stored, but they are not routinely used in a control chart. The key performance indicators are those related to the core business of the ART lab and clinic. The Vienna and Alpha Consensus meetings also defined a competency limit. So that's the minimal limit that you will need to have to be competent, to deliver good quality. And also an aspirational goal, so the benchmark, was defined by them. So I will take you through these 3 types of indicators and give you some small examples to illustrate the importance of the different indicators. Let's look at the reference indicators first. So as mentioned before, the reference indicators are related to the oocytes coming into your lab. And so they are proxy indicators of the response to the ovarian stimulation. Now, as we all know, as clinical embryologists, we are happy when we have a nice cohort of mature oocytes that have nice cumulus ovarius complexes, and so we know these are good quality oocytes. Sometimes we also have oocytes and stimulations that have not good quality oocytes, and that will influence the later quality of your work. So the reference indicators, as suggested by the Vienna consensus, are the proportion of oocytes recovered in the oocyte retrieval, and this should be between 80 to 95% of follicles measured as a benchmark, and the proportion of mature, so M2 oocytes, at the time of ICSI, which they suggest to be between 75 and 90% as a benchmark. Now let's look at an example. I've plotted here three different periods of the year 2018 for you, and you can see the Vienna benchmark. It is 25%, between 10 and 25% for those percentage of immature oocytes. And in the first period, this is 16%, so we are within the Vienna benchmarking, 17% for the second period, and 20% of immature oocytes in the third period of 2018. Now, there is a difference. We should ask, is this a normal evolution? So there is a difference between the third period and the two other periods, so we should go and look, and we might think that this could negatively influence our outcomes. The performance indicators are the second group of indicators as suggested by the Vienna and Alpha consensus meeting. The performance indicators are those for which you already collect data and you store them, you have them in your files, but you're not really routinely reporting them in a control chart. So these could be the sperm motility after preparation for IVF and IUI. So this is the progressive motile sperms over the all total sperm count in percentage ways, and that should be more than 90% as a competency value and a benchmark of more than 95%. IVF polyspermia rate, 1 PN rate in IVF and ICSI is also mentioned as a performance indicator. Good blastocyst development rate is also a performance indicator. So these are the number of good quality blastocysts on day 5 over the fertilized oocytes on day 1, and you then have the percentage. And competency value is suggested as being more than 30%, and benchmark should be more than 40%. The example I can show you here is the percentage of good blastocysts. This is for the reference population younger than 36 years old. And it's again the same three periods of 2018, the first 4 months, the second 4 months, and the third 4 months. And as you can see, it's 43% of good quality blastocysts after 5-day culture in the first period, 42% in the second period, and 57% in the third period. And this is quite surprising because, remember, we were talking about reference indicators, and there the third period showed us to have a higher percentage of immature oocytes. So this correlates with the percentage, apparently, of good quality blastocysts. So we need to look into this, we need to investigate. Now let's look at the core business. Let's look at the key performance indicators. The Vienna and Alpha consensus, they identify those key performance indicators are those related to the core business of the ART laboratory and clinic. A first one is the ICSI damage rate, so the percentage of oocytes that are degenerated after the injection. Competency value is less than 10%, but of course we aim to have less than that, so they suggest a benchmark of less than 5%. ICSI normal fertilization rate, competency value is suggested at more than 65%, but of course we aim for a higher fertilization rate, so the benchmark value suggested by the consensus meeting is over 80%. And the same for IVF normal fertilization rate, where the competency value is more than 60% and benchmark value more than 75%. Failed fertilization rate is also considered by them as a core business, so as a key performance indicator. And here the benchmark value is suggested to be less than 5%. But be aware, when we use key performance indicators, we are going to represent the data not for the whole patient pool, not for all our oocytes and embryos, but we are going to select a reference group. We are going to select a group that we will look at each time we do the evaluation of our key performance indicators. If we do not do that, we pool all the data, we will have biases because you will have patients who are over 39. They will score different qualities and different, they will have different outcomes than patients of 25 years old. Or for example, biopsied embryos, these results will be different than from your gold standard group. And you can see on the left hand in the red sentence, this is what the Vienna consensus suggested as a reference group. Female patients younger than 40 years old, their own fresh oocyte, only ejaculate sperm cells used, fresh or frozen, no PTT, and all insemination methods can be used. This is a suggestion that they give us. You will have to define for your specific lab what your gold standard, your reference group is going to be. It might be the case that you are known, your clinic, you are known for severe male pathology, so you will have a lot of testicular sperm biopsies, for example. Then your reference group will be different than the one where young patients will come to the clinic. And the mean age of that patient group is, for example, 32 years old. So you have to look into your own reference group. Now, how to represent those data that you obtain? Most of the time, a control chart is being used. And as you can see here, a control chart, the green line, will give you the average or the median as a center line. This is the mean of your results for a specific period. So I've just shown you here January, February, March, but it's up to you to decide if you use it monthly, weekly, 6 monthly, and so on. And then we have the red lines. We have the mean minus and mean plus 2 standard deviation. And the idea is that if your outcomes, your results go above or below those mean standard two standard deviation lines, then you are in a risk zone. Then something is not okay. And that's a warning sign and you need to investigate. It looks complicated, but I'll show you, I'll give you some examples. So this is, for example, the ICSI damage rate over 1 year. As you can see, the mean is nicely 3.5%. And we have a mean minus 2 standard deviation, the red line below, and a mean plus 2 standard deviation, the red line below. And in the month October, there is a higher ICSI damage rate. It's over 6%. It's outside the mean plus 2 standard deviation. So we need to investigate what is wrong there. What happened? What changed in that period? So why do oocytes degenerate? That's the first thing that you have to look into. So it is a common aspect, we know that. If you do your ICSI, unfortunately, sometimes an oocyte degenerates. So there's no panic on that side. But if it goes outside the two standard deviation line, then we need to look at what is going wrong. So it could happen during the time of denudation when a too small denudation pipette is being used. It could be that during the ICSI there is a sudden breakage of the oolemma in more than normal of the oocyte. So this is more related to oocyte quality. And then we have to maybe look back to our reference indicator data. We don't see the sonal when we withdraw the injection pipette. Again, this is an oocyte quality issue. If we use a too large ICSI pipette, this is related to higher risk for oocyte damage. If we manipulate too much within the oocyte, if we puncture too far, we bring our pipette too far in the oocyte and we will puncture the opposite side of the injection hole. Or we could also damage the oocyte while we check first fertilization on day one. Or the denudation was incomplete and we were not able to inject in a proper way. So the second question then is, we have to look at all these potential causes of our increase of ICSI damage rate. And this could be an operator problem. This could be a stimulation problem. This could be a technical problem where we're not using the wrong instruments, or there might be protocol drift. And by looking at the data, by investigating further, you will be able, and most of the time, be able to identify what is the cause of this increase at this specific period. Another example here is the ICSI normal fertilization rate. So this is the number of fertilized oocytes on day one as a function of all the M2s injected. And as you can see, it's the same thing here. As an example, the normal fertilization rate was plotted for patients younger than 34 years old, a mean of 73%, but surprisingly, in the month March, there was a decrease in fertilization rate. It goes below the mean minus 2 standard deviation. So we have to look and investigate. Now, what can happen with the 2PN rate? It is a broad indicator of good laboratory practice, the percentage of oocytes fertilized. So you have to look into the quality of the oocytes, and you have to look into the operator skills, as we did with the degeneration aspect. We will also have to look at the quality of the sperm, which sperm were used in that period. So it might be that during that specific month, we had a sudden increase of a poor oligoacinoteratospermia samples. So that could be a reason. On average, the fertilization rate is 70%. So if we go from 73 to 70, then we are still on top of it if we correlate to the literature. But for our own data, we are not good. So we have to continue to investigate. Other key performance indicators are the development rate, and this could be on day 2 and this could be on day 3. And this is in function of the normal fertilized oocytes. So again, competency values are given and benchmark values are given. The alpha consensus also focuses on the key performance indicators for oocyte cryopreservation, and they will look at the survival rate. This is a very important KPI. The fertilization rate, because these are oocytes, the development rate, and the implantation rate. I will not go into the details of the percentages, but key is that you always compare to the fresh population. Similar KPIs are being suggested for zygote freezing, as well as embryo cryopreservation. So morphological survival rate, cleavage rate, embryo development rate, and implantation rate. And again, compared to a fresh population of embryos at the center. Blastocyst key performance indicator values, in this case, slow freezing or vitrification. Again, survival rate, transfer rate is suggested as a key KPI, and implantation rate. And again, there is a reference to the results, the outcomes in the comparable population of fresh embryos at the center. If you have a pre-implantation genetic testing program in your clinic, you might want to use also key performance indicators for your laboratory to see if you are doing well with your biopsying. The Vienna consensus suggests a successful biopsy rate as a KPI, and this is the number of biopsies where DNA has been detected over the number of biopsies performed. Of course, this is not sufficient. We need to add more because you also need a healthy and viable embryo after your biopsy. So I would also add that to your key performance indicator list when performing PGT. You could also look at the immediate survival of the embryo, the survival after vitrification and warming. You can also look at at the implantation rate and the health of the baby, and of course at the rate of correct diagnosis in the child. Two very important key performance indicators are, of course, the implantation rate. That is the final state, the final check of your quality. And this is the number of sacs seen on ultrasound linked to the number of embryos transferred. The competency value and the benchmark value are listed here, but again, you have to look at your own specific reference population, your gold standard, and compare those. Compare apples with apples and not apples with pears. It might sound strange, but this is very important if you want to do an objective evaluation of your quality. We also have to look if something goes wrong in our laboratory and how many times things can go wrong and what type of thing that can go wrong. And these are called adverse events. This could be inappropriate gamete embryos that have been released for clinical use. It could have implications for the specific patient or for other patients. It could be a mix-up of gametes or embryos. It could be that we lose traceability of the gametes or the embryos. It could be a contamination or a loss of the gametes, the embryos, the tissue, resulting in a total loss of the chance of a pregnancy of one cycle. Now, things can go wrong, unfortunately. And while we manipulate our oocytes and embryos, things can happen. On average, each oocyte and embryo is manipulated 20 times. And this can happen when we are transferring between dishes, when we are denudating the oocytes, washing, doing the ICSI, checking the PNs, cryopreserving, warming, etc., etc. It is estimated that if you do roughly 100 ICSI IVF treatments per year, you do 20,000 manipulations. And of course, unfortunately, a percentage of those will be a type of serious adverse events. And it is extremely important that this is not the complete loss of the cycle for that patient. So we need to make an inventory of that as well. And hopefully this will be very low. So here is as an example, just to see if things can go wrong. These are the data from the European Commission. And in Europe, IVF centers have to register these adverse events. And this is the evaluation of roughly 670,000 reproductive cells and tissues that were used and manipulated, so to speak, for 187,000 recipients. And in the year 2017, there were 145 serious adverse events. If you look at the green bars, these are the ones that are originating from human error. And as you can see, 35 were human error when they were processed, so when being manipulated. Also during the storage, 8 cases were of human error origin. We also have errors and failure of the equipment. These are the red bars. And this is again during the processing, during the storage, during the oocyte collection or testicular biopsy, and also during the testing and the transport. So it is clear that things can go wrong. And I think this is the overview for Europe, but you can make exactly the same for your laboratory and see the adverse events, even smaller ones. You can do an inventory and do an evaluation. And to help you with that, there are different systems out there. And the RI Witness, for example, the electronic witnessing system, can give you that tool to check where things can go wrong. You can see what time it happened, which operator is involved in this, and how many times this operator is involved in an event. You can analyze per procedure and per location. So manually is a lot of work, but please scout, and there are tools out there that can help you do this in an easy, and as you can see, a nicely overview way. Now let's look at protocol drift. We can look at the operators, and we have to make sure our lab staff is doing well all the time. And they should not be doing changes without a consensus between the group and changes to the SOP. I give you an example here of the outcomes of the laboratory, the andrology laboratory, where you can look, for example, at the percentage of pregnancies per cycle in donor IOI. Why donor IOI? Well, you exclude the sperm parameter. These are excellent sperm samples. And this is then the gold standard group, younger than 34 years old. As you can see, the operator number is listed below, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And the pregnancy rate is listed on the left. The dark blue bars are the first period of 6 months, and the second blue bar are the second 6 months of that year. And the first blue bars, you can see that the outcomes are similar, around 7.8% is the mean. And after the, what you can do is you can do this observation and then you bring the team together. And what you can do is ask operator 5 or 6 and sit with operator 4 or 1 and go through the protocol. And then and check if they are doing something different. And most of the time you can see that these are small things. For example, here it could be that they leave the straw as being thawed too long outside before it is being washed. It could be small things. And in this way, by bringing the best operator with the one that is not performing as well, and they go through the protocol, your SOP, they can clearly identify differences and then change, retrain and change. And as you can see in this example, the second 6 months, all results went up. It's also because the team starts trusting each other, working together and wanting to improve and work and have better results. So if we look then on a multi-year timeline, you can see that you can improve your outcomes by bringing the team together, checking their results in a correct way, of course. And in this way, 11% the second year, it's 13%, sorry, the third year, it's 15%. So you can improve your outcomes by monitoring how your staff is doing. So let's have a look on how KPIs can help you monitor changes in protocols or new protocols that are being implemented in your laboratory. This is an example where we look at the 2PN fertilization rate in ICSI, and we are looking at the results, for example, of four operators A, B, C, and D. And again, we see three different periods of the year. The dark blue bar is the first period of the year, and the fertilization rates are 63%, 74%, and 60% for the three operators working during that time. After that period, a new type of PVP was used, and as you can see, the outcomes, the results improved. And this was the case for all operators. Unfortunately, in this you will have as well, operator A was not in the lab in the second period of that year. So you will have no data for that period. But still, the outcomes increased after using a new type of PVP. It seems that it is a small change in your protocol, but it has influences. And if you would not have monitored it, you would not have noticed that it really did make a difference and bring the fertilization rates up to 72.3%. And again, we can then continual monitoring. We can monitor the change over the year, and you can pinpoint even at which specific point this was when PVP was changed. New staff will come into the lab. New techniques will need to be trained by staff members. And unfortunately, until now, there is no internationally accepted practical training to cover laboratory techniques and skills. And there is no consensus on the minimum number of processes which would be considered as a prerequisite to acquire a license for perform a specific type of clinical embryology technique or clinical embryology as a whole. So we need to look and discuss with our own society locally, and also, yeah, you need to have a very good equipped lab. If not, you cannot train ART staff. But how can KPIs and PIs help us with that? So we will need to say for a specific technique that is being learned, what will make us decide if somebody is competent. So you need to define the determinants of competence. You need to define the specific KPIs that will say that this person is competent for technique A, B, or C. You need to log all these specific outcomes. If not, you cannot evaluate. And let's look, have a look at this really nice publication from the Sol et al. From 2009. where they were looking at the training in vitrification and warming. So they started, this was a prospective study. They started off by saying, okay, the operator, the trainee needs to do at least 50 vitrification rounds. We'll be using human 3PN embryos. And we find this trainee competent when there is no more loss of sample and the embryos have survived after warming. What they did was they used the LC-Kusum test. And the LC-Kusum test is the learning curve cumulative summation test. And as you can see in the graph, the two determinants for competence were survival. This is the top one. And the bottom one is wasted sample, so loss of sample. The dotted line, the dotted horizontal line, is important because if the outcomes of the trainee go above the dotted line, this means that the trainee is competent. And on the horizontal line, you see the number of training cycles, sessions this trainee has performed. So it was said that the trainee needed to do 50 cycles, 50 test rounds to see if it was, if he or she was competent. But in fact, after 43 cycles, there was excellent survival because the outcomes of that specific trainee came above the dotted line. You can see where the red arrow is listed in the top graph. If we look at a lower graph, stop of loss of samples was reached after 38 cycles of exercise. So in fact, the competency was obtained after less than 50 cycles of training. And this is good news. So the LC-Kusum test is actually a very nice way to sign off people that they are competent and not to continue training and training again. But signing off someone for being competent doesn't mean that you have not to continue monitoring. And here, the cumulative summum test can be used, and you can see that on the right hand of the red arrow. Here, the system works as follows. The outcomes are also plotted in the chart, and they need to stay below the dotted line. So for the survival, the operator stays, the outcomes of the operator in the vitrification and warming stay below the dotted line. And again, the same for waste of samples. There was no more waste of samples. So in fact, this method can be used and is being used already more and more to help you sign off, define competency of trainees in your laboratory. Now let's look at the successes of KPIs. Well, I think it's a big success that experts came together and made a consensus, and they have suggested key performance indicators for the laboratory. And they are suggestions. It is for you to define which one are the best suited for your laboratory, as well as the competence as the benchmark. Several publications, several studies already show that using the KPIs works. So the study of Hammond and Morbeck, and Morbeck explained as well in an excellent ESHRE webinar this year, how these KPIs can provide you with systematic and early detection of adverse outcomes in your lab. Franco and colleagues also clearly demonstrated that clinic KPIs and lab KPIs will detect problems in the clinical laboratorial interface. So it works. But you need to define your key performance indicators. You need to define your reference population and your benchmark and be realistic. Don't say you want 100% fertilization rate. Of course, that's your dream, but that's not realistic. You will have it for one or two patients. But if you set it at 100%, you will fail. So it's best to say, I want 90%, and you will reach the 90, and the next step will be, for next year, I want 95%. So be realistic. Be objective in your analyses of the outcomes, and detect where your team is strong, which techniques are really running well and giving good performance, but also detect those that have weaknesses, and then improve those. Monitor your outcomes, monitor the operator performance, and monitor protocol drift. This is so important. Regularly do an inventory of one specific protocol and ask your staff to go through it meticulously and write down what they are doing different from what is written in your SOP. And if there are big differences, retrain. Go back to the original protocol, rediscuss in the team, and look at that again and see how that will improve your outcomes. Monitor change. Have a timeline where you say when you have introduced new protocols, when you started to use a new flow cabinet, when you used new consumables, media, or whatever. So make this timeline on a sheet in your office, and it's a simple thing. Put an arrow and write down, I started to use the new flow cabinet on this date, in your yearly overview. Monitor change. When do new people start to work? When are they being trained? When are they being signed off? Again, plot these on your timeline. And it's a whole clinic approach. It's not only the lab. The lab needs to have KPIs, but the clinic needs to have KPIs as well. Are the patients happy? Are they doing well? Quality management will be a changing point for your lab. It will be a change of mindset for the team and for yourself as well. And no blame culture is key, is really essential. Unfortunately, some staff members will not accept the change, and you will have to find the optimal place in your team or the optimal activity that they can do so they will stay happy and perform well. The team spirit is very important when using KPIs. But there are also limitations. And these are that you need to have this quality management system. There is a cost involved with this. You need to have somebody dedicated to do that, a quality manager. So there's a time, there is a cost. You need to log everything, who did what, where and when. And you need to have quite a high case ratio with a good reference population for more than 30 cycles per month to do consistently a good KPI analysis. There will be a delay in visualization of the effect, so unfortunately you will not always be able to pinpoint immediately if there is an issue. So some patients, if there is an issue, some patients will still undergo that not optimal quality. Effect may also be not operator related. It can come from somewhere completely different, so have an open mind and be objective. Take time to review, discuss, and implement. Now let's summarize. So in summary, the key performance indicators in the IVF laboratory will help you to define the quality in your ART setting. There are different types of performance indicators, so choose wisely which one that you will use for your analyses. There are suggested benchmark and reference populations, but define yours for your clinic and your laboratory. Implementation of the quality management can be done via the use of the key performance indicator, and this will result in continual improvement in the quality of your work.